It was not an auspicious way to start a playoff. The Boston Celtics had played only 500 ball against the bottom of the league the last week of the season. In fact, they had lost the last two games of the regular schedule and any chance of the NBA's best won and lost record and the $3,000 a man that goes with it. Now they faced the young Buffalo Braves, who led the league in scoring. On March 30th, the Buffalo Braves played their first playoff game in the club's history. For the Celtics, it was playoff game number 222.
Bradley's presents the Boston Celtics Shopping Drill. Cowan takes the ball using his head. Nelson juggles. Havlicek fakes and drops it. Here they come through hardware. Cowan to Havlicek with the over-the-counter brand name lob pass. Alley-oop to Nelson and up those wide Bradley aisles into sporting goods. A pass to Nelson, another pass to Nelson, one more, two passes to Nelson, and a big pass from Nelson to Havlicek and Cowan for the menswear high fashion fast break. It's Nelson moving up to hey, Cowan.
Ball's no good. Okay, here's a new one.
It's the Bradley's easy return policy play. They're moving like a well-oiled machine. Yes, it's a discount price scoring drive. Havlicek to Nelson, Nelson to Cowan. He shoots a basket. And now, to the action of the 74 NBA playoffs.
Bob McAdoo was leading the Braves to what seemed to be their first playoff victory. At the end of three quarters, they held a 12-point lead. Coach Tommy Heinsohn sent his Celtics out for the final period after they had scored only 69 points in the first three. Whatever Heinsohn said seemed to have an effect on Dave Cowan. The big redhead started to hit all kinds of shots. He scored 20 points in the last quarter, the highest one-period score by any Celtics in the club's playoff history. This, combined with Don Nelson's 10 points, pulled out the victory for the Celtics. The series seesawed with each club winning on its home court. Game two was a home court victory for the Braves. Game three was a runaway for the Celtics, with John Havlicek leading the way as usual. His 43 points and nonstop effort was just too much for the Braves. Game number four looked like it might be a Boston win in Buffalo. With 9 minutes left in the game, the Celtics had a 10-point advantage. Then McAdoo, Hurd, and McMillan started to eat away at the lead. With only a half minute of playing time left, McAdoo put the Braves in front. Buffalo fans smelled victory. With 9 seconds left, John Havlicek banked in a running shot to send the game into overtime, or so everyone assumed. Buffalo took a timeout. Everyone in the auditorium knew the Braves would try to get it to their top scorer, Bob McAdoo, who had already put in 44 points. Buffalo did go to McAdoo, who fired from the top of the key and missed. But Jim McMillan got the rebound back up as the buzzer went off. The Braves won the game, evening the series at two apiece, and their fans went wild. Boston won the fifth game at home and returned to the Buffalo Auditorium for game six. The drama of that contest was squeezed into the last 10 seconds of the game. With the Celtics ahead by 2 points, McAdoo stole the ball and tied the score. Now it was Boston's ball with 7 seconds on the clock. Nelson inbounded to Havlicek. McAdoo blocked Hondo's shot right into the hands of JoJo White. McAdoo also blocked White's shot, but at the same time, he threw a block into JoJo as the buzzer sounded. Right there, the contact is made. Jack Ramsey, the Buffalo coach, did some foot stomping, claiming there should be 1 second left on the clock, but the officials ruled No time left for play. Just for JoJo's free throw. There comes a time in every man's life when he must stand alone. His teammates can't help him. His coach can't help him. He must do it alone, and the pressure can be unbearable. JoJo White came to such a time. The game was officially over if he could sink a free throw. If he missed both throws, it meant overtime on a very unfriendly court. The tension was almost physical. In a situation like this, muscles tighten and the ball becomes a lead weight. Thousands watched in Buffalo Auditorium, millions more watched on television. And the object of this pressure was JoJo White. The first won the game and the series. The Celtics were on their way to the second round and an old nemesis. For the past two seasons, the New York Knicks have eliminated the Celts in the second round of the playoffs. John Havlicek has bitter memories of the shoulder injury that slowed him, then kept him from playing as the Knicks took the seventh game of the playoffs in 1973. But this season, Boston was healthy. The big green machine went into high gear and took the first two games by wide margins. Walt Frazier turned in a 38-point performance to lead New York to a three-point win in the third game. But nothing could slow the Celts. They won the fourth and fifth games convincingly as Havlicek proved how dangerous he can be while not wearing an ice pack on his shoulder. It was a moment of personal satisfaction for John Havlicek, who has given some great moments in past second-round playoff games. Perhaps the most memorable was the seventh game of the series with the Philadelphia 76ers on April 15, 1965. The Celtics led by 1 point in that crucial game. When Bill Russell tried to inbound, the ball hit a guy wire supporting the backboard. It became the 76ers' ball right under the basket. Greer passed to Walker, and a blur came across the floor as Havlicek stole the ball. He stole it and tapped it to Sam Jones, who ran out the clock to win the series and send the Celtics into the final round for another championship. The 1974 swamp of the Knicks earned these Celtics a trip to Milwaukee for the final playoffs against the Bucks. Impressive team, and the ceremonies at halftime emphasize that fact. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was given his award as the most valuable player in the NBA. Oscar Robertson and coach Larry Costello accepted the trophy given to the team with the best regular season won and lost record. The Celtics would have been even more impressed with these Milwaukee credentials if they had not been leading the Bucks by 10 points when the presentations were made. The Boston's swarming defense with a pestering full-court press led to several opportunities for the famous Celtic fast break. Holding the vaunted Milwaukee offense at just 83 points, the Celtics won the opener and gained a split in Milwaukee. The next two games were split in Boston. Celtics won the pivotal fifth game in the Milwaukee Arena and headed home for one of the most dramatic games in NBA history. The Celtics knew that if they won here in Boston Garden, they would once again be world champions. If they lost, they'd have to play the final game in the much less friendly confines of the Milwaukee Arena. The Bucks knew that a loss meant no tomorrow. With less than 6.5 minutes gone in the game, several important things had happened. Boston had built a quick 5-point lead. Milwaukee. Milwaukee had come back to close and build their own five-point advantage. And Dave Cowens had committed three fouls. With Cowens spending a lot of time on the bench, Milwaukee built their lead to 12 points, threatening to break the game wide open. With 3.5 minutes left in the first half, Tom Heinsohn sent Cowens back on the floor, and the redhead and Paul Silas combined to close the spread. Still, the Bucks walked off at halftime with a 7-point advantage. At the opening of the fourth quarter, Cowens still had three personal fouls, and the Bucks still had a lead, now 6 points. Bobby Dandridge hit two in a row, and the margin was 10. John Havlicek got a couple of answering baskets as Boston desperately fought back. When Abdul-Jabbar hit on a 15-foot hook from the base, there was just 2.5 minutes left in the game, and Milwaukee was up by 6 points. Cowens drove on Jabbar to narrow the lead to 4. Cheney and Robertson exchanged fouls, and then each scored 2 free throws. The difference, still 4. With 1:40 to play, White found Hondo open, and the score was Boston 84, Milwaukee 86. Cowens was at the same spot with 1 minute left. He tied the score, and the garden erupted. One minute is a long time in pro basketball, and the Milwaukee Bucks can be one of the most devastating teams in this type of situation, but the swarming Boston defense in a full-court press kept the Bucks from shooting. Just as the 24-second clock ran out, Dave Cowens made a spectacular steal. It's the kind of play that bears another look, the kind of play that has caused Cowens' insurance rates to go up. With time running out, the Celtic defense kept the Bucks from getting into shooting position. McLaughlin seemed open for a moment in the corner, but before he got his shot away, the defense had pressured him enough for the shot to miss as the regulation game ended. The momentum was Boston. The crowd was Boston. Everyone knew this game was theirs. Only the Bucks disagreed. Defensive play was the key as Game 6 went into overtime. The defenders forced attackers to take low percentage shots, and there was no scoring for the first minute and a half. Then Paul Silas grabbed a rebound, found Don Cheney open on the baseline, and the Celtics led by 2. With 3 minutes gone, Oscar Robertson showed why he's one of the NBA's all-time greats. A tie again. 30 seconds later, Curtis Perry made a dazzling rebounding move and put Milwaukee ahead. Just 13 seconds from victory, the Bucks were introduced to the defensive wizardry of Don Cheney as he stole the ball and gave Boston one more chance. John Havlicek took the shot that could have tied it, but missed. But Hondo wouldn't quit. He followed his own shot, and with just 5 seconds left, tied the score again. 53 minutes of play between two great clubs, and still dead even. A second overtime. More basketball, more excitement, more tension. Right from the tip, the John Havlicek-Bob Dandridge duel continued. When Havlicek fouled on the shot, Dandridge hit 2 free throws to put Milwaukee ahead. When Dandridge returned the foul on a backdoor play, Havlicek sank a basket and the free throw. The three-point play gave Boston a 1-point lead and set up the seesaw. Jabbar put the Bucks ahead 94-93. Hondo hit his second in a row. Boston led 95-94. Oscar shot from the baseline, Milwaukee, 96-95. JoJo White tried a 20-footer, the Celts by one. Boston's defense held right to the 24th second when Oscar scooped out of the lane, the Bucks led. Havlicek's third basket of the period put Boston in front again. With a minute and a half to play, Dave Cowens got called for his sixth foul and left the game. With time running out, Mickey Davis arched one high in the air and Milwaukee had a 100-99 advantage. The clock ticked away as the Celtics maneuvered for a final shot. Havlicek aimed one for the rafter. Just 3 seconds left and the Celtics fans danced for joy. Milwaukee had time for just one shot, if that. The plan was for Robertson to inbound a Jabbar who would pass to Dandridge for the shot. But Dandridge was tightly covered, and Jabbar was forced to take the shot himself. Boston could not have defended more perfectly than it did, but Jabbar prevailed against the great Boston defense, and the series was going to a seventh game in Milwaukee. Milwaukee felt it. The experts felt it. The momentum had swung the other way. The Bucks had that feeling of rebirth, the feeling of being 3 seconds from disaster and coming back. Now they were heading home. This was the lull before they would storm the Celtics in front of those loyal Buck fans. If the Celtics knew that they were underdogs, it didn't show. Maybe the tide had turned, but they were determined upstream swimmers. The Bucks had a lot of things going for them. Momentum, psychological and home court advantages. The visitors had something going for them, too. It was called Celtic pride. Indefinable, but still it was there. The knowledge of 11 past championships, of never having lost the final game in a championship round. It had something to do with the way the Celtics had always come back. Typical was the sixth game of the 1969 playoffs. The Lakers had the Celtics on the ropes. Just moments left in the game, Elgin Baylor couldn't keep the ball in bounds, and the Celtics had the ball. It went to Sam Jones, who shot off balance and off the wrong foot. That basket won the game, an opportunity for the Celtics to go on to win the championship in Game 7. It was the last of Boston's 11 titles. Now they were to find out if Celtic pride would make it 12. If they were to win it, it would have to be on Milwaukee's court in front of a Bucks crowd. What goes through a mind of a player going into a seventh game of a championship playoff? If there is one player who could talk about it with authority, it is Captain John Havlicek.
It's like a heavyweight championship fight, and it's the 15th round, and everyone's going to give 100%, and no one's going to give up. You're going to play as hard as you can, as long as you can, and as well as you can, because there is no more one game. The season is over as of today, and this is exactly what we did.
The Celtics were up for this one, and Dave Cowens, higher than anyone as he controlled the tap to Havlicek. John fed Don Chaney perfectly, and the Celtics jumped into the lead. Just before halftime, the Boston defense, which caused 11 turnovers in the first half, started the Celtics on a scoring spree. Havlicek hit on a jumper, followed by a Don Nelson jumper. closed out the period with two baskets of his own. The Celtics were the owners of a 13-point lead when they went to the dressing room. One of the most important factors in that lead was a tremendous gamble taken by the Celtic coaches. Paul Silas remembers it well.
Before the game, Tommy Heinsohn came up with the idea that we were going to front Jabbar. Previously we hadn't, and we had good success against Jabbar playing behind him. And I thought that it was a courageous move on Tommy's part to almost change our whole defensive strategy going into the seventh game when it meant everything. But, of course, it did work. They weren't able to get the ball into Jabbar, and they were kind of stymied. After a team starts shooting poorly from the outside, they press a little, and when they can't get the ball on the inside, especially to their number one scorer, they have problems. And this was the thing that we did to change our defensive strategy, was to play in front of Jabbar. And myself and Nelson were on the weak side giving help to Collins as he would front Jabbar.
The defensive strategy worked so well that Abdul-Jabbar was held scoreless throughout the second period and half of the third. One other important factor was the play of Paul Westphal. Don Chaney got an early foul trouble. When Duck had to come out, Westy was under tremendous pressure to come through. All Westphal did was fit perfectly into the Boston defense, containing the veteran Oscar Robertson. And contribute 12 critical points. Toward the end of the third quarter, the Bucks staged a 10-point rally that put them back in contention. Fourth period, the Boston defense was still harassing the Bucks into mistakes, while the Celtics rattled off 8 straight points on baskets from close in. More defense, and a Collins-Havlicek burst of points put the game beyond doubt. Hondo started it with a drive up the middle that became a 3-point play. After Paul Westphal hit a couple of free throws, Collins hit a jumper from the corner. The Boston defense smothered the Bucks. And Dave took a pass from Westphal for 2 more points. Havlicek made it 10 points without a Milwaukee score. With a minute to go and a 17-point lead, it was all over. The Bucks knew it. The fans knew it. And Tommy Heinsohn sat his regulars down to enjoy a rare view of a basketball game from the bench. When the end came, it didn't take a basketball expert to distinguish the winners from the losers. The celebration grew in the champions' dressing room. The news of the selection of John Havlicek as the playoffs MVP didn't hurt the mood either. They had won the game, they had to win. For Coach Heinsohn and Captain Havlicek, it felt like old times. It was a familiar experience for President Red Auerbach, championship number 12 in his book of Boston. But it was a first for owner Bob Schmertz, who felt it was a pleasant experience and was willing to have it again.
Bradley's presents John Havlicek in his wide-aisle dribbling display. Hondo shows his patented Bradley's move. Through hardware, past Bradley's brand paint. He makes the turn. Through his leg. And up for 2 points in sporting goods. 2 more. John checks out some Bradley's bargains and goes up for a dunk. Then it's around the back and through the leg. Through houseware. Around the corner. Up the middle. Past children's wear. Over to automotive for the Bradley's low price dribble. Low. Lower. Lowest. Havlicek with a little fancy footwork up to mid-store. Men's wear on the left. Ladies wear to the right. He makes his move. Driving for the register.
Nice.
Jaren John wraps it up. Now let's rejoin John and the rest of the Celtics as they come home the champs.
The return to Boston was a triumphant one. The crowd was there. The city was there. There was talk of more championships, talk of another dynasty. But right now, the men of the Boston Celtics are willing to settle for exactly what they had won. The right to be called the Boston Celtics, 1974 champions of the National Basketball Association.